Chandralokas is more like a sex appeal, that oom factor, you know, that, oh my goodness, you know, this girl or guy looks so hot, you know. So moon is more of that sexual appeal, that, oh, I wish I could do this, oh, I wish. So it's more in those things, right? Chandra is more of possession, your mind is being captivated, whereas Surya is pure personality. Hello and namaste, and thank you so much for visiting my channel. My name is Karthik Gaur, and please do subscribe and click the bell icon to ensure that whenever we upload a webinar or a video, you are the first ones to know. Thank you so much. So welcome everybody, and the topic we are going to discuss today is associated with the rectification process. Okay, and what do you mean by rectification process? Is a lot of times people come up with a chart, right? And I'm sure each one of you who are watching as well feel that, you know, they have a chart which is fairly accurate. Okay, and based on that accuracy, you know, they go to an astrologer, and the astrologer also feels or takes a leap of trust and feels that, you know, it is an exact chart, and goes ahead and starts with the prediction that, hey, you are going to get married on this age. He says, no, I'm already married. Hey, you will have kids by this age. No, I already have two kids. Oh, you will have a fantastic marriage. No, I'm having a pathetic marriage. So what is happening is, somewhere down the line, you know, the chart is not able to resonate the experiences that you have had in your life. So any good astrologer is, frankly speaking, going to go with a notion that the birth time that you're giving to them is a wrong birth time. Sometimes it could be off by 5 minutes, sometimes it could be off by 30 seconds, sometimes it could be as off to 1 hour, 2 hours, and there are times when I get clients who don't know their birth time, or who have a very, very vague sort of a birth time, that, hey, I was born on 4th of May in Bangalore, you know, and my mother told me that I was born during the morning time. You know, hey, morning time could be as good from 5 a.m. to 11:30 a.m. Now that's a huge sort of a, you know, span to work on, or to take a guesswork on. So during those times, you know, good astrologers or astrologers who have learned from a lineage, or learned from a parampara, or learned from a good guru or a mentor, know how to tackle that issue. What we do is the reverse sort of an analysis. What do you mean by that? That now that you are at an age of 15, 20, 30, 40, whatever is your age, there are certain experiences that we have all gone through the life, right? That we have had a bad marriage, or we have had a good marriage, or, you know, we are living in a foreign land, or we have two kids, or we had a surgery at a particular time, or our mother died, father died, this happened, that happened. You know, at least 3 to 4 major events of life, based on which the astrologer can do the reverse analysis. Most of you who have had my consultation would know that, you know, I always start with that initial 5-10 minutes of a session where I'm asking you certain questions, you know, and most of the times I always start from your father. That, hey, if this is the chart time, then, you know, your father must be into a banking system, or he must be into a government, or, you know, he must be somebody, you know, who must be a workaholic, you know. And you all get amazed that, hey, how is he from our chart looking and telling us everything about our father and mother? The thing is that there is something called as divisional charts, and I can sort of do the reverse mathematics and try to understand that, hey, can I see the father and mother from this chart? The answer is, I should 100% be able to look at everything of your father and mother from the chart. In fact, you know, one of our students, you know, unfortunately, she lost her father today morning. And just 15 days back, you know, when we had a consultation, and she asked me that, you know, Karthik, my father is you know, not keeping well, and you know, what do you feel? And I asked her, you know, do you have his data? She said, no, I don't have a data. So I said, forget it, you know, I can look it from your chart. And I told her frankly that, listen, you know, it's extremely tough, you know, extremely tough to sort of, you know, go beyond next 2 months. And if he goes, then, you know, we should consider ourselves lucky. You know, sometimes you don't tell it as openly, you know, because you are not a god. So obviously you don't want to tell it with confidence that a person will survive or no. But as I told her, you know, I would be very surprised if he would cross. And she lost her father. Okay, so all the Guru Mantras that we did today would be for her father. Okay, and let us all pray that, you know, her father sort of gets a good sort of a journey and he is able to get moksha. But what I was trying to tell you, that there are certain ways by which we can rectify the chart. And amongst that, you know, the complexion of a person is a very important complexion and is a very important part of rectification too. And every graha has a particular complexion, and we are going to talk about it. What is the sex of a graha? You know, by meaning sex, I mean to say whether it's a male, female, or a eunuch. How do you see homosexuality in a chart? You know, it is seen, what does homosexuality mean? That your sexual orientation or your sexual preference is more towards your same sex. Or in today's time, you know, there are many people who are bisexual and different types of things nowadays people are, right? So we are going to talk about that, and we are going to talk about the devatas also. Okay, so what are we going to understand is, you know, we are going to focus on the graha guna, and more importantly, the complexion of the grahas. Okay, so what is the complexion of the graha? First and foremost, we are going to talk about the navagrahas. Now that we know the complexion of the grahas, only then will we be able to understand how to look at the complexion in a chart. Okay, for example, Ravi, which is Surya, is dark blood. So it is not just red, but it is almost like, you know, a maroonish red, or, you know, very, very thick red. That is the color of Surya. And this all can be used, in fact, for branding, logo creation, and many other factors, provided you know how to do it. Okay, and provided you know where to look for. Okay, Chandra is more of a white, or very sort of a faint yellow, cream color, jisko bolte hai, you know. So very, very light yellow, combination of white and yellow, so to say. That is Chandra. And then there is Mangal, which is more of blood red. So he is that normal red, whereas Surya is more of a darker blood red, more in the maroon sort of a thing. Whereas Ketu is also dark red. Okay. Whereas Mercury is dark green. You know, almost a little one shade more higher than the slide. You know, slide is more like a little light, but, you know, add a little more green to it, or from 80% make this 100%, you know, that would be the dark green of Mercury. Okay, almost like a green chili. You know, you see that pure green chili, it is very green in color. Not that Shimla Mirch, which is the big one. Not that. The real sort of a chili. That is the clear color of Mercury. Okay, whereas Jupiter is also white and light yellow. Okay, but so it is more of a yellow, but not sort of a cream color. You can see that yellowish color. If you see a original yellow sapphire, you know, if you are lucky and if you see an original yellow sapphire which is unheated and untreated, then you will see that it will be very, very light color, yellow. But when you put it against the light, you can clearly see that it is yellow in color, but it is not very, very dark. You know, it is light yellow. That is the real color of Jupiter. Okay. Whereas Venus is all about your dark brown, brown color. So those are the colors associated with Venus, and it is not white. The sign Taurus can be associated as white, but at the same time, the sign Libra is black in color. Likewise, we'll be talking and I'll teach you all about the signs as well and the colors of the sign in the next sessions. Whereas if you look at Rahu, Rahu is actually more of blue-black color, but pitch dark. You know, whereas Shani can be sky blue. You know, whereas Rahu is very, very dark black or dark blue, you know, something, you know, which causes depression. And hence, when you wear a blue sapphire, generally you don't wear a very, very dark blue sapphire. Why? Else it will cause a depression. Okay. So, but it is used in some other therapies. Okay. Now, Lagna, now once that we know how the colors of the Navagrahas are, we need to know the impact of these planets on the Lagna. Okay. So, whichever planets have the maximum impact on the Lagna and the Dasha also is very important. So sometimes, let's say you might have multiple planets afflicting Lagna or impacting Lagna. In that case, it all depends on the planet whose Dasha and Antardasha is working on. You know, that's the reason when sometimes some people are pretty dark in color, but in certain Dashas, they suddenly become very fair. Or the reverse also happens, that, you know, a child which is very fair, suddenly after 28, 30, you know, something happens and it becomes very brown and dark. So that depends on the impact of the Dasha. When there are multiple planets, then technically you depend on whether the planet is friendly to the Dasha Lord, Antardasha Lord, or not friendly. Okay, now, your Lagna has a lot to do with your skin tone. And frankly speaking, we are talking about your Rashi Lagna as well as Navamsha Lagna. Okay, now, the first house and the ninth house is very important. Okay, for example, why? Because ninth house is your past, whereas Jupiter or your Lagna is something which is your present. So let's say if somebody is born with Jupiter in Lagna, but let's say Saturn in the ninth house, then a child is born very fair. Why? Because the Lagna is going to denote now. But if there is a malefic, let's say ninth lord or ninth house is Saturn, then over a period of time, it tends to become browner and, you know, the color becomes darker. Why? Because Saturn after the age of 36 is going to sort of play its part. Hence the skin complexion, skin tone sort of changes. Okay? And that's where I said that the Dashas become very important. We'll be going into the planets which, you know, and the signs in detail. But what I mean to say, generally when you see Moon and Jupiter, they are planets which are extremely fair. You know, it gives a person a very, very fair complexion. You know, especially when it is having Graha Drishtis or Rashi Drishti. Graha Drishti is still temporary. When I teach you Drishtis in detail, I'll be able to guide you much better. But in general, what you can understand is that Graha Drishti is more temporary. And it is conditioned based on the Dashas. Whereas Rashi Drishti is more of a permanent feature. Okay, and both have their different impact in different Dasha. But what I mean to say is the Dasha become very important in terms of understanding out of the multiple planets which are giving you a Drishti on the Lagna, which is the one planet which is sticking onto it. Okay, and that is something which we'll be studying today through example charts. As usual, I believe that, you know, example charts are very important, because the moment you sort of study things from example charts, then it's easier for you to retain it. Okay? As usual, you know, we start with Lord Ram. Okay? And we know his chart. He is Karka Lagna. Okay? With Venus in the ninth house. So here we see that Moon and Jupiter are in Lagna, and the ninth house also has Venus. You know? Which means that technically, you know, he could be very fair and he would become very fairer. Is there any impact? Any other planet having an impact on the Lagna? Yes, we do have. Here we have a Saturn in the fourth house, you know, which is, you know, having a Graha Drishti, 10th house Drishti on the Lagna. Now, I'm sure some of you are confused in terms of Drishti, etc. I'll be teaching you from October 11th. Okay. But currently, just understand and try to follow the class that Saturn has a Drishti, Graha Drishti, on the 3rd and the 10th house from where it is. So, 10th house here is Lagna. So, Saturn does have an impact as far as Lagna is concerned. So, Saturn during its period of Muladasha can actually temper his color a little less fairer. But generally, if we see, he would be extremely fair. Because there are three planets aspecting that. And then there is this Mangal, which is in the 7th house in Maranakaraka and in Exaltation, having a Drishti on the 7th house also. But Mangal's Drishti on the 7th house is, frankly speaking, 25% effect. Why? We will study it later on. Why? Because it has only a one pada Drishti on the 7th house. And that is the other extreme of understanding Drishtis. But what does the great Purana says? Okay, or generally, you know, when we sort of Google search or do a Wikipedia, he says that it is dark blue skinned, like we have given, you know, the picture is of a dark blue skinned. And he stands between 6 feet and 7 feet, and his arms almost reach his knees. That means his hands, you know, or the arms, which is the third house and the 11th house, are extremely strong and they are long as well. So are they true? The answer is that, you know, they might not be wrong, because they might be talking about Lord Rama during his exile. And that exile, by now we know, was the Muladasha of Shani. And Shani, because it is impacting the Lagna, so compared to his fairness, you know, he could have become a little less fairer. But generally, would you say that he is a fair complexion? The answer is yes. We have Guru and Moon in Lagna, the very, very fair. And then you have Shukra in trines, you know, and in the ninth house, and that too in exaltation, which means that it is absolutely confirmed that, you know, throughout his life, you know, except for that Saturn period where he might have gone a little darker in complexion, else he was having no issues as far as his skin tone is color. Okay. However, at the same time, you know, can we look at Lord Krishna? He is also called as Ghanashyama, Shyama Varna, which means that, you know, he was not fair. You know, hey, but here there is Moon in Lagna. Okay. And we also have Jupiter aspecting it by the Drishti. We call it as Graha Drishti. Okay. And Jupiter has the Drishti on the 5th and then the 9th house from where it is. So Lagna is 9th from Jupiter, which is in the 5th house. So Jupiter is also a fair planet. So here we have two planets, you know, which are giving them a fair Drishti. Now let us look at any other aspects. You know, here we have Saturn, which is aspecting Lagna. Here we have Mangal and Rahu, and Mangal is in debility, having a Rashi Drishti on the Lagna as well. So here we see that there are planets, you know, which are giving him, you know, not so fair looks also. Hence it is a fact that, you know, Shri Krishna is called Ghanshyama for a reason. there is a very famous song or a famous bhajan, you know, Yashodanandan se bole brijwala, Radha ko kyu gori, main kyu kala. And that's a fact. When Lord Krishna asks his mother, or Mausi actually, you know, that why is Radha so fair and why am I so, I am not fair. And that is this impact of the benefits on the Lagnesh. We have to understand that this Lagna Lord is also Venus. Prima facie, Lagna Lord is Venus, which is going to this Rahu and Mangal. So to that level, that skin tone is being diminished. Now let us understand the sound advice. Okay, here I have given two types of complexion, and sometimes both this complexion can be there in a human being. I remember when I met a film star long time back, and you know, he was pretty like almost dark brown. And then we lost touch, and after like 5-6 years, he again, you know, we met, and suddenly he was extremely like fair. Like, means we would say wheatish, you know. So there was a huge transition. And he had moved between dashas, and the dasha was absolutely different to the last time when we met. And the first thing that I told him, that wow, you know, you are in a different dasha altogether. And there's something positive which is happening. And he said that, yes, I'm actually doing a lot of Ayurveda and basically drinking a lot of kadha and all those things, as a result of which I'm able to change my skin tone. So you understand, he went into this, Mercury and Jupiter were together, and he went into that dasha, as a result of which Mercury is all about Ayurveda, green leaf, leafy vegetable, you know, eating organic, those stuff all are in that sort of a thing, vegan, all those things come under that sort of an umbrella. So what I mean to say that a complexion will tell you which is the planet which is dominating. And complexion has to be seen in Rashi and Navamsha, or the impact of a planet on Rashi Lagna as well as Navamsha Lagna. Very, very important. You know, why Navamsha? Because Navamsha is a past life. And sometimes there are certain people who are having a full life based on Navamsha only. Okay. In a way, it means that their life is on a recording. Their life is just a recording which is being played. As a result of which, you know, almost everything that they do doesn't have a positive impact or a negative impact, at least as yet. So a lot of time people complain that, hey, this person looks, is doing so much of ugly karmas, you know, why is karma not taking a sort of a revenge on him, and why is it that this person is still enjoying all the good things in life? Probably because he has come with a great traveler's check, as a result of which, you know, the person is so happy, the person is actually able to overcome a lot of his negative karmas based on the savings with which he is going to come. Similarly, a complexion is also an inheritance. Okay, so this is something which is important. Now, how do we assess looks or good looks? There is a difference between it. Jupiter, Moon and Surya are planets, you know, which define good looks. But again, each one has got a different sort of advice to give. For example, Jupiter will give you attractive looks, or for that matter, you are intellectually very attractive. Why? Because people find you as Jupiter. The way you speak, the quantum of knowledge that you have, or you can almost debate in every topic. You know, it is just that purely Jupiterian pull, you know, which attracts other people. You know, that out of the 100 people in that room, they want to come and talk to you. They want to come and approach you. They want to spend some time with you. They want to seek advice from you. All those things are associated with Jupiter. Whereas Chandra looks is more like a sex appeal, that oomph factor. you know, that, oh my goodness, you know, this girl or guy looks so hot, you know. So moon is more of that sexual appeal, that, oh, I wish I could do this, oh, I wish. So it's more in those sense, right? Chandra is more of possession, your mind is being captivated, whereas Surya is pure personality, you know, where certain people have just that great personality. When they walk into the room, you know, they sort of lot of heads turn. Why? Because they are 6 feet tall, you know, strong voice, you know, the nice posture, you know, nice suit, everything about them is so perfect. It is purely Surya. You look at them, you feel like it's a king. Yeah? Can you say Amitabh Bachchan has got more of that Surya sort of a personality? Where when he dresses up, when he enters, when he sort of speaks, you know, he has got that great attribute. Or that image of being a leader. You understand? The second in the rank is Venus and Mercury. But Venus and Mercury are again something, you know, which is coming because of Rajas. Oh, wow, you know, that person has a great... he always wears an Armani suit. Okay, he always... His watch is brilliant. You have seen that Rolex watch in his hand. It looks so good. Or look at that lady, you know, she always has this best of Burberry purses or this best of watches, or, you know, look at her sari, you know, she is always so well-dressed and, you know, she has a stylist. So everything around, you know, your looks, or everything around your wealth or an aura around you, you know, which creates your beautification. You know, you come out of a good car, you know, everything around that is Venus, very beautiful. But that Rajas part plays a major part in terms of that attraction. Mercury is attraction by speech, by sense of humor. That, oh, this guy is so funny, you know, I love him. You know? Something like that. Whereas Mangal and Shani are not in contention for looks. They agree that, hey, we are not those so-called studs or babes or whatever you call it. Right? So they are more in terms of, they say that, you know, hey, we are not competing. You know, that's why we are very secluded. That's why Shani is more of an extrovert. Why? Because it is too conscious about itself. You know, it feels that, you know, oh, I'm too short. You know, shall I wear a heel? Or I've seen some guys who wear heels to look tall, you know, because somewhere inside they have a psyche that I'm not that tall. So Shani and Mangal sort of give a little bit of stunted sort of a look. Whereas the other five planets give sort of great sort of looks in their respective domain. Okay. Now, Mangal, within Shani and Mangal is one which gives a short height. Okay. By default itself is short. But the problem with Shani is Shani gives you this hunchback, or let's say your posture is not good. You know, you see certain people, you know, they sit like this, or, you know, generally while they're sitting, you know, their shoulders have dropped, and slowly, you know, they have almost become the tortoise, you know. That's why it is called as hunchback, you know. So there is a part of their height which has come down, as a result of which they look shorter than what they are. Okay. Whereas Shani can stretch the body. You know, Shani in Lagna, good height. Surya. Surya in Lagna is super height. I've got Surya in Lagna. I'm 6 feet high. You understand? But I have also Shani aspecting the Lagna. So to that level, I have to take care with my posture. There are times when I'm working, my posture can droop a little. Then I have to again focus myself, you know, hey, sit properly. Otherwise, you'll have a back pain. You understand? So very important. Whereas node put an aura around them where they look darker. Nodes are Rahu and Ketu. Okay, and sometimes they can give a very colorless sort of a appearance, which means that a person looks like a ghost. The person is so fair, almost no blood, you know, and you feel that, you know, that person is either having a disease, right? And that is what the nodes do. Nodes put an aura around it. So either you start looking darker, but you are not actually dark. But it is just that it gives you a little bit of a pale look, you know, a little bit of, you know, that aura where that there is no shine, which is there. Okay, and this is seen, again I'm repeating, from the stronger among the Rashi and Navamsha. Always start with the Navamsha first. And that's why, you know, sometimes, you know, when somebody does a consultation for their child who is too small, then when the child is too small, frankly speaking, I don't have much sort of things to fall back on apart from their father and mother. In that case, you know, I always ask for the photo of the child just to see the complexion, just to see which are the prominent parts in his face. Is his nose beautiful, or is his eyes beautiful, or his ears are bigger? You know, depending on that, I can do the rectification. Okay, so it's very interesting that, you know, we can use such minute details to actually rectify the chart also. Okay, now, what are the gemstones associated with those particular planets? Surya, because it has got that complexion, you remember, the darkest sort of maroonish, you know, very, very dark, you know, it is associated with red graha, which is ruby, or what is called as manik. Whereas Chandra is all about the gemstones associated with, you know, we call it pearl, but pearls are also of different types. Sometimes I give yellow pearl, sometimes I give black pearl, you know, sometimes it is pure white, you know, and sometimes there are different colors of pearl, you know, but generally, as far as branding and other things are concerned, if for Chandra, you can also use orange. Okay. Whereas the infrared rays, these are all the rays which are associated and the colors which are associated with it. Okay. Now, when it comes to the gemstones, it is a little different. Okay. You use a certain gemstone to heat yourself, and there are certain gemstones which are to cool themselves. Okay. I've talked about it in detail in the gemstone conference. So it is already there on my YouTube. So you can go ahead and access it. But what I mean to say is topaz is generally a Agni gemstone. You know, it is used to heat up the system. So if, let's say, if it's an Agni Rashi gemstone, okay, and it is associated with Sagittarius sign, then Sagittarius is an Agni Rashi. In that case, you can wear something called as topaz, you know. But then let's say I, within myself, you know, I've got both the gemstones. So there are times when I use the yellow sapphire, there are times or months when I use yellow topaz. Those are higher principles, but currently you can understand that, you know, for Pisces you can use yellow sapphire, whereas for Sagittarius you can use topaz. Okay, whereas Venus is all about heating, you know, then you use diamond, especially when relationship is very dull, or, you know, marriage has become very cold, there is no intimacy between husband and wife, then diamond works very good. In fact, it is the hardest metal. It is not easy to cut a diamond. Okay. Whereas we use something called as white coral also, and that is used for cooling. You know, if there is too much of Shukra, there is too much of things happening around, you know, then you want to cool down a little. So for those, we use the white coral. Okay. Always understand the odd signs, you should heat them. The even signs, you should cool them. Okay, here we are talking about the signs, you know, so you understand the difference, like I gave you the difference between Sagittarius and Pisces. Okay, Rahu, we always use a gemstone called as Gomed, but Gomed should actually be Gomutra Gomed, which means that it should be yellow like a urine, the color of a urine. Okay, but not when you are sick, you know, light sort of thing, something that Pranab Mukherjee wore, you know, our late president, you know, he expired a couple of days back. But Pranabda, when he was the finance minister, or where he was the home minister under Manmohan Singh, he used to wear a nice Gomutra Gomed. Check his pictures, you will see. Okay, whereas Ketu is associated with cat's eye. Okay, so it is very important. You already know that Surya is associated with ruby, Moon is associated with pearl. Within pearl, there are many types of pearl. Okay, if let's say if Saturn, if Moon is being aspected by Jupiter also, or you want to activate a Gajakeshri or a Fame Yog, then you can give them a South Sea pearl also, which is yellow in color. Else you can wear a pure white color. Nowadays you get black pearl as well, red pearl as well, you know, God knows different types of pearls. Okay, then for Mars you usually use coral, for Mercury you use green emerald. Okay, and there are different shapes as well. In fact, for relationships you always use round shape gemstone. For finance you always use a square shaped gemstone. Okay, and the other shapes for other purposes in life. Okay, and that is majorly the gemstone part of it. And sometimes you can use gemstone for your enhancement of skin as well. For example, somebody has got a lot of pimples, or somebody has a lot of boils, or somebody has got issues with their skin, or somebody is looking very old compared to their age, you know, there are gemstones which can be given. Especially Maharishi has said that if you have Atmakaraka in mercurial navamshas, then person tends to look younger than his age. Okay, and try this on any chart. You will find out that, you know, if the Atmakaraka is either in Virgo or Gemini in navamsha, the person will look younger than their age. Okay, so this is a very, very powerful secret I have told you. Now I wanted to talk a little bit about the importance of Graha Devta, okay, and the importantly the sex of the planet. Okay, now Devata comes from a word called Diva. Diva means light. Okay, so Devata is that who is going to increase the light in a house or in a nakshatra or in that particular aspect of your life. And every Devata is associated with a Graha to an extent where the Devata has an ability to light the Graha or light the house or remedy the Graha or remedy the house. So the Devatas become very, very important. And within Devatas, there are two categories. One is Adi Devata and the other is Pratyadi Devata. Adi Devata is the one before, Pratyadi Devata is the one behind. Okay? Now, I'm giving you a very, very important rule today. Okay? If it is a benefic graha which needs to be pacified, always use Adi Devata mantras. I repeat, if it is a benefic which needs to be propitiated or remedied, always use Adi Devata. But for example, let's say if it is a malefic, you know, for malefic, you always use Pratyadi Devata for the influence to, you know, for the malefic influence to lessen down and to ensure that it is business as usual. Okay, if a planet is exalted, then it is always the avatar. Okay, for example, if somebody has Moon in Taurus, it is Shri Krishna. If I have Mangal or I have Surya in Mesha Rashi in exaltation, that it is no other than, none other than Sri Ram himself. Whereas if it is in divinity, then it is Mahavidya. Okay, and we'll talk about Mahavidyas in later on, but let us understand the Devi Roop. Mahavidya is nothing but the mother. Okay, and so if a planet is in divinity and if you want to do a sort of a remedy, always go for the Mahavidya. Okay, now generally the gender of the planets, you need to know which planet is a male planet, which planet is a female planet, to understand, you know, how's it going. Among the planets, Mars, Jupiter and Surya are male planets. And among the Rahu and Ketu, Rahu is the widower, you know. So he's more like the male widow sort of a thing, you know. Whereas the two Jala planets, Venus and Moon, are female planets. Emotions, right? That's why they say that women have more emotions, men have less of emotions. Okay, so that is very important. And Ketu is the one that, you know, who has no periods, you know, that what do you call a woman who has reached that 50 plus age and is getting a little more cranky, that is Ketu. Whereas Rahu is the male widow who has gone 50 plus and is getting cranky, you know, who has got no other work to do but sit in the house and, you know, just keep harassing everybody else. So that's a very negative Rahu and a negative Ketu, right? Both have become headless, you know. In India, you know, in a colloquial language, we say, ke, you know, like Buddha Satya Gaya, like, you know, after 60, you know, or this old man is acting as if he has become 60. Satya means 60. It is actually a very, very logical word, which means that after 60, your brain cells are dying. And to a large extent, we all, when we reach that stage, you know, there is a deterioration which is happening. And we will study that when we understand the dashas. How after a certain age, automatically our brain is sort of drilling down. Okay, whereas Buddha and Shani are neutral, okay, and hence they are associated with homosexuality. Okay, Shani is the one which is too old to do anything, so he has already reached that level where mind says yes but body says no, right? But Mercury is somebody, you know, who's too young. So though there is a difference, though Mercury and Shani, you know, in a way, you know, one of it cannot do anything, the other one is yet to explore it. And when both of this planet have an impact on the seventh house of Navamsha, then there is a problem with the sexual orientation per se. You understand? So that is what we have for today. And what I'll do is I'll close the recording, and whatever questions you have, in fact, we have some time, so we can take a lot of questions as well. Okay, thank you. Namah Shivaya. Yes, please. What is your question?
Guruji, my question is that in the color scheme of planets, you mentioned Shukra as dark brown. But if you see the stones, you know, normally the diamond is again on the whiter side or clear side, and opal again is a white side. So how are we looking Shukra as a dark brown or a brown color? Why is it symbolized by that color?
What is the best gemstone for Shukra? You know, it is a black diamond. But okay, if you hear the prices of the black diamond, probably with one diamond, I can teach you for the next 50 years. That is the cost of a black diamond. Then there is also a yellow diamond. Yellow diamond is used for when Jupiter and Venus are together for Dviguru Yogas. You know, now I'm talking about how to use gemstones for yogas as well. So you will understand which is what is the sign of the Tula Rashi. Black color. It is the business house.
So okay.
Danda.
You know?
Yeah, so it is black color, that marketplace. Everything is happening, right and wrong. Everything is happening. It's a dark color, pitch black color. And Shukra likes that. And Rahu is in Digbala over there. It says that I can look, Rahu can look through the dark. You know, hence I give you the example of a bar and, you know, Gemini, discotheque, you know. People like me would even not be able to see anything. You know, only a Rahu can see in that dark. And that's why you need a Rahu exalted in Gemini to be very, very prosperous in nightclubs or gambling for that matter. And that sign is in trines to Tula, which is also a black sign. So Rahu says that very much, you know, I can deal with that. Money and blood, you know, but I can deal with it. So that is how it is. You will have to understand. Slowly, slowly you will understand. The thing is that, see, you are here just looking at it and seeing everything. So for Rahu, you use the Gomotra Gomet. By your logic, Rahu is Jupiter. Gomotra Gomet is yellow color. It doesn't work that way. You know, logic is different. It is a lot based on signs also. So slowly, slowly you have to build it up. One by one, you know, as you grow, you will start building up and rest of the things will happen. Yeah.
Thank you.
Any other question?
Kartikji, one last this question. Is, hi, Kartikji. This is Smita. I have a question. You are talking about if a planet is debilitated, then you pray to Mahavidya. What about if a planet is actually, if you have a planet dasha going on, for example, like a Mercury, Mahadasha or Antardasha going on, do you also still consider it debilitated and pray to, say, Mahavidya, or how would one do that?
Why would a dasha planet be necessarily debilitated?
No, that's what I'm asking.
You have to see the avastha, no? So if the dasha planet is well placed, then let's say if I'm going through Surya Dasha, then I'll play to Shri Ram, you know. So you have to see, why would the avastha of, sometimes, you know, the planet might be in a normal friend's house. Sometimes it might be in an enemy's house, because there are more to it than just these four avasthas, no? What if the planet is in Mula Trikona? What if planet is in Digbala? What if the planet is a Vargottama planet? But these are the four things I'm teaching you today.
If
the planet is exalted, look at the Vishnu Avatara, and that Vishnu Avatara is going to feed you throughout the dasha. If the planet is in debility, then you need to go to the Mama, because you will cry. You will feel humiliated during that period, and only Mama will take care of you. You know, it is like when a child, you know, he is crying, you know, father is too busy. Father is watching his TV, father is doing his work, father doesn't care. You know, he feels that, okay, he must have fallen somewhere, he'll be okay in 5 minutes. But a mother immediately comes running, oh, why are you crying? You know, you need food, you fell down, what happened? Come, I'll apply this. That is how a debilitated planet works. Only the Mahavidya is going to pamper you. Only the Mahavidya is going to go out and fight that, hey, who is bullying my child? Hey Saturn, hey Rahu, I'll beat you up. Don't you dare touch my child again. And that's why you need a Mahavidya.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, thank you.
Namaste Guruji. I have one question.
What's your name?
Aparna here, Kartikji.
Yeah, Aparna, tell me.
I have a question. This is regarding yesterday's webinar. Can I ask?
Yesterday's webinar, okay, ask.
This is regarding the Guru Paduka. When you were explaining how to identify the Guru, I have Lagna.
Not identify the Guru. The blessings Guru coming.
The blessings, you know, coming.
So you cannot just look at the 12,000, you know, put a search icon and find the name of a Guru. Yeah.
Okay.
Your experience with the Guru generally, yeah.
Okay. I have a question. See, if I have my Lagnesh as Jupiter in the Lagna, and so the 12th house will be Karkataka. Karka.
Then how is it Lagna, Lord in Lagna? Jupiter is exalted.
Exalted, yeah. Jupiter is exalted in the Lagna. And yeah. So 12th from the Jupiter will be the third house.
Gemini.
Gemini. And Gemini, the Lord of the Gemini is Mercury. Mm-hmm. And Mercury is again, usually they say Vishnu should be or, you should worship Vishnu. So is it that you will be connected to some guru or somebody who is a Vishnu worshipper or something of that sort?
No. That is too stretching too far. It doesn't work like that. Those are the attributes that you need to see. See, Gemini is getting the full advantage of that exalted moon or exalted Jupiter. So you can at the most say that attributes of Gemini is something that can be very much there in your guru. Somebody, Gemini is all about somebody who is being very friendly, somebody who is a good communicator, somebody who is not a very, very, very old sort of a guru, you know, somebody. So you can find out for those gurus who give you a very, very modern outlook, you know, rather than somebody who are very, very giving you a very, very old output, you know. Again, you know, this is something, you know, where the Paduka is there. It is not exactly, but it is the seat of knowledge over there. Yeah. And it is in the 12th house, right? Your guru is in Lagna. So 12th house means it could be a foreign land, or you know, you can meet the guru while you are in a foreign land, and it is more of a Diksha thing, you know. So it is used more for the blessings of the Diksha and all those things.
Okay.
Yeah.
And one more quick question, where is the Gayatri Ashram what you are mentioning in India?
Google it.
Okay, fine. Thank you. I found one in Haridwar. Is it
that is the one which is the best.
Okay.
So that is the main branch. That is the main branch, and there are a few others also, but in smaller places. So sometimes what I used to do is I used to go generally with a bigger group of 30-40 students. Then we would arrange them to come and do the Gayatri wherever we are. You know? But individually, definitely, they wouldn't come where you are. But then you need to find out. Or if you go to probably a Somnath or those places, then you need to find somebody, you know, who will do that. Okay.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Sure.
Hi, Sudhindra here. I just wanted to know this list of Adi Devata, Pratyadi Devata. Is there a list or,
there is a list.
Okay. See, second thing I just wanted to know is that you look at if a benefic is placed in a Dustana, do you still do the same remedies or there is something different?
What is the role of give me an example, not from your chart, but general.
But general, let's say Ketu is in Lagna.
Okay.
Let's say in Mars, in Aries. So that is a graha, that's a malefic, which is in a Kendra. So in that sense. So then would you do it for, you know, or rather, you know, okay, so I'll change the example. Let's say Saturn in fourth house. Saturn is a malefic. Or Saturn in sixth house, I'm sorry. Then sixth house is a Dustana. Saturn is a malefic. So how do you look at it? How do you look at the planet or you look at the house?
Both actually, because you mute your so this is much better. So both actually, you know, see what happens is, why is Saturn bad in the sixth house? In fact, Saturn is superb. Why is Saturn bad in the eighth house? Saturn is superb. See, this is where you have to understand that, you know, a malefic planet like Mangal. Why is Mangal bad in the third house? It is superb. The root things that you need to understand that benefic planets are superb in Kendra. Malefic planets are superb in the Dushtanas. So if Shani is in the sixth house, it is a beautiful place to be in. The problem is like what you gave before, when Shani is in the fourth house. You know, that is where Shani gives problem, because it has got no business to be in the place of happiness, you know, because he is somebody who is a Vairagi and somebody who has given up and somebody who is going to cause a depression wherever he is going to go. Why is he there in the fourth house? Why is he giving sadness to your heart? Why is he giving you an experience which is not a good experience in your home country, or vis-a-vis your mother, or vis-a-vis the fourth house per se? You understand? So you will understand slowly, slowly. You have to understand that there is a lot more to it, and hence I always say that knowledge is an ocean. You know, you are just trying to program it and then trying to, you know, see the result. It is not like that tadka that, you know, today you see 3-4 things and immediately you prepare and then you are going to put that, and suddenly you find it doesn't work because there is a little more to it, you know. But we are on the right track. What I mean to say is you are now able to question the right way, and I like the question that you asked. But only thing that you missed out is people feel that Dushtana means no planet should be there. Now that is where the catch lies, that hey, Saturn would be good over there. For example, when Lagna Lord, let's say Saturn is in Lagna Lord for, let's say, Karka or a Makara Lagna or a Capricorn Lagna, Lagna Lord Saturn in the 12th house is superb. But Meena Lagna, who's that here? Pooja, why are you unmuted yourself? Thank you. I'm already speaking. Don't unmute yourself, please. You know, it creates a disturbance. The whole recording goes for a toss. Okay. So Saturn, when we are talking about Lagna Lord, Saturn Lagna Lord going into the 12th house is superb. Why? Because Shani is the Karaka for the 12th house. So why would Shani as Lagnesh be bad in the 12th house? But similarly, you can't take that as a thumb rule and think that, hey, Meena Lagna, Jupiter in the 12th house is superb. No, it is not good. It is a Sura planet which is going into the malefic house or Dushtana. We will understand that. That is what I wanted to do is, you know, once we start doing a webinar once a week, you know, I'll be able to give you a lot of homework to do, you know, rather than doing this every day. We'll be doing it. Okay, so this is how I want you all to start thinking. You are thinking in the right track, you know, but then there is more to it, you know. What you are thinking is a unitrack mind, that hey, in this houses planets are good, this houses planets are bad. No, it is not like that. Mangal in the third house is superb. Any person with Mangal in the third house, Shri Krishna has got Rahu in the and Mangal in the third house. Could anybody defeat him? And why they couldn't defeat him? When people saw that, you know, it is a malefic over there. It can bring struggles in life, but who cares as long as you have the ability to get out of the struggles? You understand? So like that, we'll have to understand. That's why I give you example charts of Shri Ram and Krishna. Most of your Jyotish, you should understand from their charts. Don't get obsessed about your chart. Keep your chart in the side. You know, because you'll always be biased. You know, no matter how fair you try to be, you will never be able to see your chart fairly. Or even for that matter, the close, your son, daughter, wife, whatever it is, close people's chart. You are never supposed to look at them. And that is the rule among Jyotishis. Okay? Any other question? Pooja, you wanted to ask something?
Sorry about that earlier, Karthik. I'm continuing on the topic of Aparna from yesterday's session, 12th from Jupiter. What happens if the house is empty?
You have the Graha Drishtis, you have the Rashi Drishtis, you have to see the Lord. That is what we will learn next. The aspects part of it, the Drishti part of it. How do planets see? Because each planet is coming with a past life desire. So that desire is completed based on the drishti. यू नो मेरी सामने वाली खिड़की में एक चांद सा मुखड़ा रहता है, यू नो. सो व्हाट इज दैट सेवेंथ हाउस दृष्टि दैट एवरी प्लैनेट हैज? व्हाट डज सूर्य सी इन द सेवेंथ हाउस कंपेयर टू व्हाट शुक्र सीज कंपेयर टू व्हाट मून सीज? एंड व्हाट डज द मंगल सी? Mangal is said to be somebody who is a celibate planet. Seventh house is the house of relationship. Is Mangal even interested in the seventh house of relationship? If not, then you know, how do we prove it? So that whole proving comes when we study the Grah Drishtis and Rashi Drishtis and all. And then slowly these things will start getting clearer to you.
Okay, and from today's session, when you said about odd and even signs, you're referring to the solar zodiac signs, like Gemini is number 3, or is it by the months?
Months? With which regard you are saying? I remember the odd.
The slide. Regard. Yeah, the slide before this had it. Yeah, or odd sign, even sign. Yeah, gemstone
part of it. You know, there are two houses for a particular sign. For example, Jupiter has got two houses, yeah, Sagittarius and Pisces. So one is odd, one is even. Venus has got two houses, you know, which is Taurus and Libra. One is an odd, one is an even. So like that, we have to see. Whenever there are dualities, you know, one of the houses is heating up, the other one has to cool down. You know, hence I gave you the example. But two examples are about Jupiter and Venus.
But if you have a Agni, if your Tattva is more Agni, then you wouldn't recommend a Agni gemstone. You would recommend a cooling gemstone. That's what you mean.
No, not necessary. In fact,
not necessarily. Okay.
Sagittarius is an Agni house. And I'm saying that, you know, give a topaz, which is actually more heated. You understand? And Tula, yeah, is an odd house again. And here we are saying that, hey, wear a diamond, you know, which is again heating. That, hey, in relationship, you need to be, you know, having some sort of a chemistry. You can't be brothers and sisters in being married. Whereas in Taurus, it is cooling down, which is all about your family. It is all about creation of wealth. So within family, you don't need to have a lot of Agni. You know, you need to cool down. If there is a problem, you know, discuss it, get it sorted out. In business, you know, or making money or eating food, you know, cool down a little. So one of the places it is in the even houses, you know, because it is more of a feminine sign, it is telling them to cool down. Whereas in the odd signs, you know, because of the male power or the ego associated with the male planet, it is heating up. Something like that. Slowly you will decipher it. More and more as you learn, you know, and start making your notes, you will be able to compare your notes, you will be able to sort of write more into it. Always keep a little few blank pages with every particular topic, because you will, you know, through the years, you will keep writing more and more notes over there.
Thank you.
Okay. We'll take the other questions tomorrow, and I'll see you all tomorrow. Thank you. Namaste Jyotisha lovers, thank you so much for viewing the video. Please do share so more and more thirsty souls can benefit from this free knowledge which is being shared. Also do subscribe, click the bell icon, and all the questions that you have, please mention in the comment section below. Thank you so much, and please keep supporting us.